because when I say that, nobody stood up and started throwing anything at me. Golf pros have another way of looking at things. Daily rolling and mowing putting greens promote excessive green speeds. Again, majority of golfers aren't good enough to play on greens as fast as what we see at Augusta National and in the professional events. Yeah. We don't necessarily need to do that unless we are hosting a professional tournament. That's a whole other ballgame. Stone walls and waterfalls. Who's played golf in the last week? Who's played golf in the last month? Okay, I haven't played in 6 months, so I feel for you guys. Have you played a golf course with a waterfall? Can you remember right out of the gate? No, you don't remember? No waterfall?
No, you don't have waterfalls.
Beautiful, very good. You don't need waterfalls to enjoy the game of golf. GPS and golf carts. First, I'm a promoter of walking. But GPS slows things down. I hate GPS. Why? Because I'm distracted. I'm constantly looking at the GPS and wondering how quickly am I playing or not. I can't stop doing that. But it's something that we never needed before. It's a convenience that slows play down. Curved wall-to-wall cart paths and routine edging of cart paths. There's where we talk about perfection in golf course maintenance. Fact of the matter, in America, we're going to drive anywhere. And I've been here three or four times, and I've seen how you guys drive. You don't need curbs either, okay? What you need is 30-foot-wide cart paths. But anyway, so curved wall-to-wall cart paths and routine edging of cart paths. Waste of money, waste of time. All this is based on golfer perception leading to industry reaction. The industry thinks that golfers want all this, but the golfers, I don't think they want this. I did a survey. It's called The Golf Experience Your Way. And if you go to a website, you come to me and ask me about it later. The website is called SymposiumOnAffordableGolf.com. It's a conference that I've been putting on in America for about 5 or 6 years. And I did a survey called The Golf Experience Your Way. And I asked golfers about all this stuff. Do you like this? Do you like this? Will you pay more if you have this? Can you live without that? And everything that I went through is based a lot on what the survey showed. Golfers don't want what we, the industry, thinks they want. And we, the industry, are spending a lot of money to give the golfer something that they don't want. So, go to the opposite extreme, bells and whistles. Well, this is what golf was originally like. It's hard to see with the light in here, but I understand we're filming. Look at the bottom right-hand corner of that. The rub of the green, look at our old retaining wall sitting up there to keep the mounds in place. And look at he's got a problem. He's trying to figure out how to extricate that golf ball from that beach. Nobody was irrigating that sand and nobody raked that sand bunker ever at that point. That's what golf is about. Golf is a character builder. You hear that, right? We always talk about golf being a character builder. Well, it ain't anymore because we're fed perfection. We don't have any challenges on how to extricate ourselves out of real golf challenges like this book, okay? Instead, we're complaining about not having perfect conditions, and that's a problem with society in America. Don't know about here. That we're always fed perfection, and when we don't get perfection, we're spoiled, we want it. And it's true with golf. So, I beat up on golf a little bit, beat up on golf course construction a little bit. So what do we like about golf? If we want to eliminate waterfalls and irrigating sand bunkers and all, what do we want from golf? What is an attribute of the game? What do we enjoy? Well, interesting green contours. Let me ask you a question, Ed. I don't want to put you on the spot, but who would rather play greens that have interesting contours where you have to aim one spot and play to another, but they're puttable versus flat greens where you have to be perfect with your putting stroke? Something much more interesting is interesting green contours, am I right?
Definitely.
So, cross hazards that challenge the golfer and not penalize the golfer. I'm going to get through these details in a little bit. Bounce and roll, undulation, converging lines that lead to a sense of mystery, human scale of golf course features, wind. Golf started in the British Isles, and that on Lynx golf courses. Lynx is not a marketing term. Lynx is land that links the wetlands to the highlands. And it's always sandy soils, and that's where golf originated. And that's where wind is, with no trees. Match play against an opponent instead of a score. In America, we're obsessed with our scores. I'm obsessed with my score, unfortunately. And it's a bad habit. I'm trying to get out of it. I can't. But I used to love match play. Match play is what it's not, because it doesn't matter. You can win with an 8 if your opponent got a 9. If you got an 8 and you're playing metal play, you're going to be unhappy the rest of your round. So that's the attribute of the game. It's mano a mano. A thought-provoking second shot on a par 5 hole. A drivable par 4. A very short par 3. The challenge of just hitting the ball flush with your 5 iron. Solitude within nature. Strategy over aesthetics. When I go and talk to people, to clients, I always say, I'm more interested in the strategy of the golf ball than aesthetics. And inevitably, someone comes up and says, you don't like to make things look good? No, no, I love to make things look good. I love to make things look good by making them look natural, or taking the natural features of a piece of property and making them aesthetically pleasing. But aesthetics in America, and aesthetics in golf course architecture in modern day, is let's put 5 bunkers out there to the right of the landing area and have all the lines work together like a big giant puzzle. You know, that's not aesthetics. That's a lot of bunkering. So, what can we do with that? I've been counting less is more, right? What can we do with that? Now, I know you came in early. I think you were with me at Manitrust Center when I gave the same talk. Mohan said everybody's going to forget, so it's okay to leave. Okay, what can we do without? We can do without perfect rough. Just like when we're watering sand bunkers to control our lies, we're doing the same thing with rough, trying to create a consistent playing surface, even though the rough is very deep. Well, if you have consistent rough deep as a golf, deep rough as a golfer, you know how to play that shot. Whether you can play the shot or not is another story. But we've made golf too consistent again. Golf is that character builder that has a lot of questions. So in this situation here, we just have natural areas for rough right there. What happens when you play out of there? Every single shot is different. You may be in deep grass in one shot. You might be on sand or clay in another shot. You might be nestled up against a plant on a third shot. So there's variety. We're minimizing variety in the name of consistency in golf course design. Variety, you've got 3 different shots to play. Why is golf monotonous? Because every time you hit a poor shot, you have the same type of recovery. Golf is all about variety. Variety is the spice of life. All right? And we can do without TVs, right? And we can do without windmills. We can do without framing our sand bunkers with a different type of grass to draw our attention to that sand bunker. We do that a lot in the United States. And there's some maintenance theory behind that. Here, this is a golf course in Arizona where it's all warm season Bermuda grasses, but the people here have put zoysia grass on the faces of the bunker. Why? Why would that be? So that, because zoysia grows a lot slower than Bermuda, and you don't have to mow it as quickly. But frankly, you don't have to mow. Maybe if we just looked at bunker edges and decided we don't have to mow them much anyway, we can just stick with Bermuda and let it just get a little rough. We could also just not put any grass around those bunkers and just let the natural grasses take over. Give it that rough look that hazards are supposed to have. We certainly shouldn't be framing grass for visual like here. Again, I'm sorry, it's hard to see in the light, but this is a green here with a bunker at the ocean course at Kew Island. You might remember the 1991 Ryder Cup, and then Rory McIlroy won the PGA Championship 3 or 4 years ago. Do you remember? Is it funny I can remember it? It was the 1991 Ryder Cup, but I can't tell you what year Rory McIlroy won. It was 2012 maybe. So, but what has happened here over the years, in preparation for the Senior PGA Championship, which was prior to McIlroy's event, the owners decided to grass the face of this bunker, and it is literally a 2-to-1 face. And that bunker is about 9 or 10 feet deep, instead of leaving it natural, because they wanted fairness for the professional golfer. And who wants to maintain that 2-to-1 slope that's 10 feet high? No hands have raised, I understand. What can we do without? Someone earlier today was telling me about a clubhouse somewhere. South India, which was just huge, 40,000 square feet, but it was the thing. I'm not a big fan of big clubhouses because that requires a lot of maintenance. And if you have a country club and you're going to do a lot of different things with those clubhouses, that's another story. But if you're just a pure golf club, you don't need 40,000 square foot clubhouses. You don't have to have campaniles that look like a St. Mark's Square in Venice. What can we do without? Perfection again. Here's a sand bunker. This is TBC Sawgrass, another PDI golf course. Perfection, where for maintenance ease, because they don't want the bunker sand to get contaminated, they put a grass edge of 3 feet wide. But there, you're going to require a little mowing consistently. So you're exchanging one maintenance issue or aesthetic issue for another that eventually will get worse. If we could just accept, I understand the logic behind this, but if we as golfers can accept lesser conditions, you guys wouldn't have to deal with perfection here. If we as an industry can convince golfers that golf is golf and not perfection, we'd all be better off. Mission Hills, okay, in China, one of the courses there. A dog leg left, there's the green. Okay? These bunkers are in a great position. It's a strategic hole, somewhat heroic, where the point is to cut the corner to gain as much advantage as you can. If you want to play straight, stay away from the sand, you'll have a longer shot into the green. But if you want to carry the bunkers and you're successful, you have a shorter shot into the green. Great design. But it can be achieved with one bunker instead of three. These bunkers here are doing nothing but penalize the golfer. So when most golfers stand on this tee, they're forced to hit right here. It's become a penal golf hole because there's sand left and sand right, and the golfer really only has one place to go. Not the greatest design if you're seeking variety, but if you want to create a situation where it's really difficult, that's a good way to go. Nonetheless, you can really just accomplish that with one bunker here and one bunker there. Five bunkers in the outside corner of a dog leg left hole. Whose shots are going to end up there? Or what type of shots are going to end up there? Miss hits, poor shots. Is the professional ever going to be in these bunkers? He might be in this bunker. He's rarely going to be in these bunkers, but all of us are going to be in those bunkers.
Yeah.
And we're going to slow play down. And you have to maintain these bunkers just in order to make a terrible experience for the average golfer, right? We can do without stamped concrete. Last golf course you guys played that had stamped concrete car paths, do you remember? Good. Do you remember your last golf course where the greens were really fun to putt? That's more important, right? People are spending money on these things, and the cost is transferred to the golfer, and that's why golf an unsustainable sport or game, whatever you want to call it, in the United States and really in China, in some places here in India. So it's a titanic task to change the mindset of golfers and of the golf industry. And it took 40 or 50 years to get that titanic going in one direction. Hopefully it won't take that long to turn it. So, again, I'm beating up on perfection, right? So let's go the opposite way. What is acceptable to golfers? It's, of course, my opinion, but I'm trying to move that Titanic, so I need some help. Get you guys on board. Seminole Golf Club, a great Donald Ross golf course outside Jupiter, Florida, built in 1928. Back in those days, they didn't have soja grass. They weren't trying to frame fairways or frame sand bunkers visually. They weren't irrigating rough. And over the years, Seminole, just like every other golf course in America for the most part, went from one end of the pendulum to the other, to the pendulum of perfect fairways, perfect rough. And then they finally realized that they have lost the character of the golf course. Whether it's a Donald Ross golf course or not, they've lost the character of the golf course. Okay. And so now they've decided, okay, we're going to leave these out of play areas to just be natural, which is what the essence of golf is. It's one of the reasons why this piece of property is unique to the whole world than anywhere else, because the parts of it are left natural to be what it was before golf even showed up. And that's one of the attractions of golf. So, what is acceptable? Fairway playing surfaces like that are not acceptable. And I understand that. I don't want to play in fairways like that. And that's why they're focusing their energies down the center line, right? The landing area is the fairway, best playing surface on the golf course. There's no reason to have perfect playing surfaces if you've hit it to the left. Or to the, you know, to the right or to the left, far beyond even the hazards. So we can minimize maintenance by not maintaining every square meter of a piece of property. Just like us as architects should be redesigning every square meter, maybe we don't need to maintain so many acres of land. Allow nature to influence conditioning. If you let nature take its course away from your center line of play, your job gets a lot easier, right? And your boss's money goes a little longer, right? This is Cypress Point on Monterey Peninsula in California. It's an Alistair McKenzie golf course that he very smartly utilized great sand dunes and got variety of his routing his golf holes by utilizing those sand dunes in many ways. And in this case, he's using a sand dune as a backdrop for the green. This is the first hole here. And what's great about this is here's the playing surfaces, and you can see it's not perfect back in the 20s, but yet it thrived back then. And as slowly as you go back into nature, the manicured looks go away and it just recedes into nature. Less maintenance to be done there. Okay? Now on the flip side, this is a university golf course at my alma mater, University of Georgia, where they're on a limited budget. But they're focusing down the center line. Okay, the tees are sufficient enough, but look at all those weeds on the slopes of the tees. But yet, that golf course is always busy. Have we been to golf courses that had perfect slopes to tees, but no one was there to play or walk along those slopes? Why? Because it was too expensive. Right, but that's the mindset that our industry has. Perfect conditions. Perfect conditions where we're not even playing.